So after yesterday's fun and games with this thing, I came back to it today and spent a bit of time just cleaning up the solder joints, making them more rigid, adding solder, stuff like that. And it occurred to me that I don't remember, with all the shenanigans of people doing this thing at breakneck speed, I don't remember anybody ever actually explaining how the circuit works or what it does. Well, what it does is pretty obvious. It's voltage, it's an adjustable power supply, but how does it do its magic? Well, that's what I'm gonna do today. The heart of the thing is this lm317 voltage regulator in a TO220 package. That voltage regulator and its cousins. There's higher current versions. There's also fixed voltage regulators at various voltages, but those were the sort of the staple of linear power supplies for decades before switching power supplies became a lot more common like they are today. So yeah, as I was saying, the LM317 and cousins have been popular since, the late 70s when it was invented. It's capable of handling anything from up to 37 volts input, with a 40 volt differential between the input and the output, amp and a half current. So yeah, it's a pretty useful general purpose voltage regulator. And the way you adjust them is by putting a fixed vo or a voltage on the adjustment pin that is a volt and a quarter lower than what you want your output to be. You can do that in a variety of ways, but there's one really common way, and that is this. You just put a voltage divider between the output and ground, and set that to so that it gives you a volt and a quarter below what you want your output to be. There's ways of calculating that, but most of the time, you just do it experimentally. You do it with put a pot in there as a voltage divider and set it to what you want, and then measure it and put in fixed resistors if you choose to. Or you can just leave the pot in there, really, and have a volt an adjustable power supply like this one. And here that is again, sort of on the data sheet. A couple of capacitors for stability. Those aren't obviously mandatory in the most basic circuit, but you generally want them. This one's got a fixed resistance between there and then an adjust just a trimmer or a variable resistance to ground to basically create that voltage divider, right? And there is the math if you want to figure it out without doing it experimentally. And here is that same circuit that we saw from the Wikipedia article and from the data sheet, just thrown together on a breadboard. LM317 there, that fixed resistance going down to a pot set just as a variable resistor, not as a voltage divider itself. So the voltage divider is between the pot and that resistor, and then just an LED across the output with its own resistor just for good measure, and measuring the output. So I've got 12-ish volts coming in. Turn him on. With the pot set to the minimum, getting 1.14-ish, 1.1 something volts out. But as I adjust the pot up, it comes up fairly quickly. I've only adjusted the pot maybe 20 degrees, if that. And there, the pot's at about half, and we've already maxed it out with that voltage. At a different input voltage, you're going to have a little bit different swing of the pot. But to get, let's go back down here, see if we can get 5 volts or almost. Okay, so there's 5-ish volts. But if we bring in another meter here and we measure between that adjustment pin and the output pin, we'll see that it's 1.25 volts, exactly 1.25 volts, just like the data sheet said. So now, if I adjust that pot down, we should have the same pretty much voltage there, pretty much 1.25 volts. Now let's get this thing out of the way, and we'll take a look at the kit there, which is similar to this, only it's got a few more components going on. So I took the liberty of reverse engineering this thing off camera just because that's a slow and painful process. But can you see that okay? I think so. So on here, the first thing we have is these four diodes, which form a bridge rectifier. So you don't have to worry about the incoming polarity. It can be AC if it wants to be. That will create DC out of here. Then you've got a big 220 microfarad smoothing capacitor, this one, and a 104, which is 100 nanofarads, something like that, 0.01 microfarads, 0.1 microfarads. For smoothing, the lower frequency smoothing there and just high frequency stuff with the EDBD capacitor, that goes into pin 3 of the LM317, which is the input pin. I drew them more conveniently here. This is how they really are laid out. Pin 1 is on that side, pin 2 is in the middle, pin 3 is on that side physically, but just for convenience I put them like that. There's a reverse protection diode across the thing just for good measure. That's this little guy sitting vertically down in here. Then on the output side, I'm going to ignore the control stuff for a second. On the output side, we've got the 470 microfarad capacitor just for more smoothing, and the 104 again down there just to keep any high frequency crud out. Then we have the FU. Yes, that's what it's really called on there, which is apparently some sort of a PTC protection fusible thing. I don't know. The indication says fuse, but everybody's been calling it a PTC resettable fuse. I guess that's kind of what it is. Then the switch is in series with the output and with the LED and its 5.1K resistor. And then off to the output speaker terminals here, which are poor design because the red one is actually ground and the black one is actually the positive. Okay, now into the weird part, because they didn't need to go that carried away. So if the transistor wasn't there and these two connections were tied together, let me just like that, then it would work just fine, just like this one does. But they didn't do that. They added in this little transistor in here, which, as far as I can tell, doesn't do a hell of a lot. When this is right down at the bottom, basically the base of that is grounded, so it's not going to be turning on. Once that starts going up a little, or up a little bit, the transistor is going to turn on. But I don't know, it's going to be in its linear position for a little while, so it's going to be acting like a sort of a resistance between that and creating voltage divider anyway. I don't see the point for that. I don't think it adds anything to the kit, but it also doesn't make the kit not work, so what the hell. But yeah, that's basically it. So just like it says in the data sheet, as long as we create a 1.25 volt drop between those two points, or a 1.25 volt potential between those two, which is from this voltage divider rig down here, then it's going to work. And as we adjust the resistance, it's going to create its own little closed loop feedback in there to maintain whatever output voltage you want. Yeah, just a little quickie here, just because, like I said, I don't think anybody's actually gone over this circuit, or at least nobody who's been involved in the speed test shenanigans. Well, hope that was interesting or informative, or a nice diversion on your weekend morning. Thanks for watching. Talk to you later.